Hello, my name is Mr. Poothick, and in this video I will be detailing the history of a country by the name of Eisenland, which is based in the Minecraft Stoneworks server. And if you don't know what that is, I'll include a link to give a full rundown on what the server is and what it's all about. And without further ado, let's get right into it. The day is March 2nd. A nation in the southeast of Rathnir by the name of Valtirion has just been created, and it is expanding its borders to include a collection of islands around it. Valtirion's king, Alex Potter, designates various governors to the individual islands in order to more efficiently govern them from the capital island of Balhurst. This form of governance held up for a while, and all was going well until two governors of the far west islands of Valtirion started to get fed up with Alex Potter's incessant meddling and his methods of rule. Only 5 days after Valtirion's inception, on March 7th, 2021, in a joint move, the western collections of islands officially seceded from Valtirion in a bloodless revolution. And thus, two new countries were made. The inhabitants of these islands deemed themselves Northland, and the two people living on this island deemed themselves Eisenland. Northland decided to be led by Wiawu, and Eisenland led by Kaiser Ablaze Genie. It was at this time that I joined Eisenland and was granted the position of Chancellor. When I first arrived, all that greeted me was a single building built from a mixture of cobblestone, dirt, and wood. It looked pretty bad, and some small farms. Pretty lackluster, but the country was freshly independent and we had big plans. Right after joining, work began on the government building, expanding the island, and working on gathering resources. It is also in this period in which Eisenland's incredible foreign ministry leader and eventual person of fantastic influence, Ryan von Dirksen, joined. This power combo of me, Mr. Poothick, Ryan, and the Kaiser formed the first council for Eisenland. The three of us made important decisions, with the Kaiser having the final say in anything. This was Eisenland's first form of government. Over the course of the next couple of weeks, Eisenland's island grew in size, due to artificial expansions, and in players. Soon enough, the city of Eisenberg was penned for the name of the only city in Eisenland. Also, in order to show solidarity, Eisenland and Northland thought up of a plan to merge their islands together, in order to better facilitate trade. And the strong alliance that these two young nations shared grew. But all was not well, as on May 19th, Northland underwent a coup. Northland's new leadership told Eisenland that they would continue to uphold their alliance and trade agreements. However, a member of the ex-government in Northland revealed to Kaiser Ablaze Genie that Northland's new leadership was putting up a facade, and that they were actually talking with Alex Potter of Valtirion about recapturing the island of Eisenland for Valtirion, in exchange for protection and riches. This immediately sent Eisenland into a frenzy. Arms were made, walls built, and the merging project immediately cancelled, and the nearly complete connection between the two nations was severed. Thus began Eisenland's first Cold War, as no actual combat came from this period. However, tensions were incredibly high, and neither side wanted to be the first one to draw blood. After 3 weeks of these increased tensions, Northland began to split due to inside disagreements, with half of the people advocating for transparency and peace, and the other calling for war. This crippled Northland's activity and national spirit, and after a week of relatively no activity from Northland, Eisenland's leadership decided to take action. Eisenland forces encircled all of the land claims belonging to Northland with their own claim. And after a full week of no opposition from Northland, the admins deemed them inactive, and with that, all of Northland's land claims were transferred to Ablaze Genie, and on July 8th, Northland was no more. After doubling in size, Eisenland entered an era of great prosperity. Work resumed on connecting the islands, and more buildings and infrastructure were completed in order to facilitate player growth. It's in this period in which a player of international fame, and certainly the pride of Eisenland, Hero, joined the country. Hero immediately proved to be an invaluable member of the team, as for his first project, he renovated this fort, and this is his first project, completed in only 3 days. Hero is an incredible and dedicated guy, and Eisenland definitely would not be where it is now without him. On a side note, it was around this time in which the original island connection project was completed, and Eisenland was nicknamed the Turd by the international player base, and for good reason. I mean, look at it. Eisenland also forged a strong military alliance with the nation of Skjoldebrødre. Hey, I'm sorry if I butchered that. At this time, as Eisenland had pledged and sent military support for their endeavors in the world of Eldheim. As time marched on, more players joined the nation, and Eisenland decided to expand once again. But this time, they were looking at their old ruler. Just a little over a week after annexing Northland, through many conversations, the High Council of Mr. Puthik, Ryan, and the Kaiser all agreed that taking over Valtarion was now a necessity, as they had gone on to become inactive, and their islands were more of a security risk or a liability at this point. On July 14th, justifying themselves to be liberators from incompetent leadership, and with no resistance from the townspeople, Eisenland officially annexed the towns of Ozenia and this unnamed island to the north of Valhurst, which we deemed Little Rock. After no response was given from Valtarion leadership, Kaiser Ablaze Genie made the executive decision to charge full steam ahead, and officially declared war on Valtarion in order to completely take control of their lands and their capital city, Valhurst. It was at this moment that Alex Potter became quite outspoken against Eisenland and spouted claims of rule-breaking and war-mongering to deaf ears. And despite all of these claims by their leader, townsfolk living inside of Valhurst, especially a person by the name of Bandy, told tales to Eisenland leadership about ridiculously high tax rates, up to $500 a day, and how inactive Alex Potter was. After hearing these complaints, Eisenland's resolve against their former ruler grew. On July 14th, Eisenland's declaration of war against Valtarion came to fruition. Eisenland forces, soldiers from their allies Skjoldebrødre, and one volunteer mercenary, King of Havoc, stormed the capital city and were met with no resistance. In order to officially win the land war, town members of Valhurst actually agreed to get online in order to be killed to give Eisenland points. After an uneventful hour, all of Valhurst had been picked clean, some buildings were blown up, and some buildings burned. And with that, the last Valtarion city fell to Eisenland. After Eisenland's capture of Valhurst, the country found itself with more than twice the amount of land that they had only a couple of days ago. And this had many problems, as now Eisenland had to deal with settling the newly acquired islands and finding the funds to pay for land claims, and who to trust to appoint as governors. In order to solve this, trusted members only were granted governorship to be delegated to the newly acquired territory. Bandy, one of the old citizens of Valhurst, and an Eisenland sympathetic, was installed as the mayor of Valhurst. Mr. Puthik was assigned to Ozenia, and this island, Little Rock, was deemed as a military zone, with land ownership being handed over to Eisenland's military leader at the time, Mr. Zane. Instead of being assigned a mayorship, Ryan got high up in the ranks of the UBSR and managed to score a colony for Eisenland on UBSR land. With all of this sorted out, things were looking good for the future of Eisenland, and work began on increasing Eisenland's income, building up and repairing the new lands, and making a name for itself on the international scene. However, not much was needed in order for Eisenland to become internationally recognized, as Eisenland's neighbor to the immediate north, Valturis, saw Eisenland's recent acquisition of Valtarion as a quick and easy way to gain control of the entire region. And on July 27th, 2021, the King of Valturis put out an ultimatum to the National Announcements Board stating the following. Attention, leaders of Eisenland, you have 24 hours to respond to this ultimatum. Either join the Valturis Kingdom or we will declare war. After some panic deliberation, the Eisenland Council retorted with a blunt refusal. And following Eisenland's announcement, talks began with the Valturians on when both sides would be ready for conflict. A date was settled, and both sides called it a day. War was on the horizon, and Eisenland was woefully unprepared. Early intelligence gathering determined that Valturian forces and their allies would far outnumber Eisenland's supporters. And on top of that, only half of Eisenland's able soldiers were equipped with the now standard Protection 4 diamond armor set. To address this, Eisenland went into overdrive in terms of military production, and this is where Hero and Mr. Zane shone in terms of their dedication. Both managed to not only make ridiculous amounts of money, but also create more than enough weaponry and arms for Eisenland to have a considerable chance at successfully defending itself. And as the time grew near, we were ready. The tide suddenly turned, however, when a new recruit, Industro, was chosen to become a spy. Industro was the only Eisenland spy who actually managed to get trusted into Volturan land claims. And once they were in, they immediately found something incredibly damning. It turns out that he joined Volturus right as they were constructing a massive TNT cannon pointed right at Eisenland's capital building from their siege fort outside of Eisenberg. This is against server rules, and he reported it to Eisenland's leaders, who in turn reported it to the admins. And this was enough to get four of the best Volturan soldiers banned from the server for a week, and provided Eisenland with a lot of political leeway, as they now had claims of warmongering and rule-breaking to plead to other countries in order to gain support. Industro's actions were undeniably the best thing to come out of this affair, and it immediately put him on a pedestal of fame inside the country for his service. As the day for the declaration of war came, Volturus was quiet. Confused as to what Volturus was doing, Eisenland leaders reached out to Volturus, and were met with no reply. At this, Eisenland decided to take on Volturus offensively, and on July 28th, the only member of the High Council that was online, me, Mr. Puthik, declared an offensive war in the name of Eisenland on Volturus, going straight for their capital city. The public war declaration brought attention of the affair to one Loic of Viadoxa, who immediately contacted Eisenland leadership with the offer of military support in the war against Volturus, thus beginning a close relationship between Eisenland and Loic. It turns out that Volturus' behavior in the past had created immense beef with Viadoxa, and Loic saw this war as an opportunity to exact punishment on them. Loic's Viadoxan forces immediately constructed a siege fort outside of the Volturan capital and mobilized their forces. Eisenland now had a real army backing their cause, and word about the situation traveled fast. Here was a relatively new island kingdom getting pushed around by an established and mildly powerful nation. At the thought of this, people wanted to be on the good side of a war, and with the arrival of Loic's army, people from the UBSR, Solitudinum, Dawnstar, Volunteer Mercenaries, and of course Eisenland's allies, Skuldebrandir, all showed up in mass to help Eisenland. And by the time the date for the battle had rolled around, the invasion force was gathered at the siege fort, with Loic being designated as the general for this operation. It certainly was a sight to behold. Here were people from all over coming together to squash an evil, warmongering state. Shields bearing the flag of Eisenland were handed out to all in attendance, and the plans of battle read to the troops. Occasionally, Volturan soldiers would try and shoot at the siege fort, or get close enough to pick off a random soldier outside, but were all driven away by either barraging arrow fire or a small squad of soldiers. Many Volturans were killed this way, so many in fact that their heads were put on pikes surrounding the fort to ward off any others, as they were starting to get annoying. The time to the start of the battle drew even closer, and all the soldiers rallied outside of the fort and began their march towards the city. When the invasion force arrived, they were met with arrow fire from the walls of the city, but not enough to do any real damage. The army dug in outside of the walls, exchanging fire with the defenders, and waiting for the battle to start. However, this is where something crazy happened. Tortugan soldiers, all clad in netherite and with riptide tridents, had shown up to see the battle, and were flying around the area. And unfortunately for the Volturans, they decided to focus their arrow fire on one of the Tortugans, and this resulted in their immediate doom. The Allied army watched in awe as the Tortugan squad all shot up in the sky, flew over the city walls, and proceeded to slaughter all of the defenders inside of the city, 4 minutes before the war was to start. And with that, the Tortugans left without a trace, taking the dead soldiers' items and leaving the city defenseless. When the battle had officially begun, the Allied army marched in with a vengeance. And And once inside the city, the Allied army proceeded to slaughter civilians, almost for sport, chasing down random defenseless people and cheering when one was killed. Buildings were blown up and burned, items stolen by everyone. It was mayhem. And at the end of it all, New Velotra was just a burning husk, and the Volturan leadership was left with nothing but hate for Eisenland and those who helped them. And honestly, understandably so. After the Negative Four War, or the War of Broken Promises, Volturan leadership left for a new land up north. Eisenland nearly tripled in size, and had now entered the global stage on Rathnir, and combined with the friendships they had made with their allied nations, was no longer some tiny island any longer. Eisenland leadership knew that they were left with more land than they knew what to do with, and ideas were shot around on what to do with Arcturus. And soon, the plan was settled. Divide Arcturus into three zones, the north, the middle, and the south. The north was deemed to be kept as there was a city and a holy site already there, and the mayor of the area agreed to be under Eisenlandian rule without a hitch. The southern area, which consisted of New Volotra and the surrounding land, was planned to have future renovations, as the capital city in its current state was just unsalvageable. The plans thought up for the middle section of Arcturus, however, were massive. This is where the concept of Maxstadt was drawn up, and man, was it going to be a big undertaking. The city of Maxstadt was going to be the greatest city in the southern hemisphere of Rathnir, and maybe in all of it, to give Eisenland international fame. Eisenland entered another era of prosperity. Little Rock's structure and defenses were completed. The city of Balhurst, which was now under the mayorship of the famed Industro, was seeing unprecedented levels of growth in terms of buildings and player count, and the Maxstadt project had begun. In conjunction with the Good Times, the Eisenland Council, now consisting of the Kaiser, Mr. Boothick, Ryan, Industro, Mr. Zane, and Hero, all decided that a mixed form of democracy and monarchy was the best way to run this new Eisenland. Thus, elections were held, and Industro won the presidency, with various other members of Eisenland winning representative positions. Eisenland also focused on becoming rich at this time, with a new armaments factory being constructed and production of raw materials increased. Industro became incredibly rich during his stay as president by selling enchanted diamond or netherite armor. And many Eisenlandians managed to make hundreds of thousands of dollars, but Industro was certainly the most lucrative. And when all was going well, disaster struck again. On September 21st, Industro out of nowhere murdered a citizen in Balhurst, and went rogue in the Eisenland Discord and blasted anti-Eisenlandian words to the masses. However, the Kaiser was quick to action, and Industro was banned from every land and the Discord. And the Kaiser also managed to get in contact with the admins. However, before the admins could do anything, Industro managed to take all of his valuables, his wealth, and materials and log off indefinitely. And this series of events was a serious blow to Eisenlandian morale, funds, and weaponry, but life continued on. Mr. Puthik took up the mantle of president following this unexpected departure. Mr. Puthik's presidency was very controversial due to the nature of his installment. The various political parties at play in the nation began to bicker, and this actually resulted in some murders happening in various towns and some heated arguments over how the country should be run. And on September 27th, a state of emergency was declared, and all political parties forcibly disbanded. The situation continued to decline, however, and on September 30th, martial law was declared, and democracy was thrown out the window in Eisenland. After these dramatic turn of events, the whole of Eisenland began to slow down in terms of growth, with many players going inactive. Hero, however, stayed hard at work, and managed to single-handedly build up Maxstadt, constructing incredibly large structures like the Eisenland Capitol Building, named Loic Hall as a symbol of gratitude, and this statue of the Kaiser, some commercial buildings, all of this by himself. As the scope of the Maxstadt project grew in size, more builders were assigned to work on the city to expedite the process. And to this day, the project is still under progress. Alright, I'm going to backtrack on the timeline, as all of what I just told you is what happened domestically in Eisenland after the Negative Four War. However, Eisenland was also beginning to get extremely active in the international scene during this time period. After acquiring Arcturus, Eisenland began talks with other Sparwood nations in order to form the second iteration of the Confederation of Sparwood States, consisting of the UBSR, Eisenland, Acratia, Montaire, Unaro, and Avertico, on August 18, 2021. This alliance was made as a result of the fear of Tortugan invasion, as they had grown extremely aggressive and expansionist at the time. And the CSS fears were realized when on August 20th, Tortuga declared war on Acratia. Preparations were made by all of the CSS nations to help Acratia. However, due to incredibly incompetent leadership by Acratia's premier, M.W. Niaz, these preparations to defense were in vain. Acratia was invaded on the 24th of August with not so much as a single CSS defender helping. Following Acratia's invasion, fears of Tortuga invading Eisenland became very real, and these fears were realized when Tortuga started to commit bandit raids throughout the Eisenland islands. In order to hastily come to a solution, the council agreed to sign off on an agreement called the Treaty of Eisenberg, in which Tortuga vowed to not invade and to stop committing raids on Eisenlandian towns in exchange for control of Eisenland waters and a huge Tortugan ship to be built right in the middle of the Eisenland archipelago. It is still there to this day. And to add insult to injury to the CSS, the UBSR was swallowed by Frostmire on September 6th. And on that same day, Eisenland, Tilipia, and Unaro all left the CSS and created a new union called the Free Union of Sparwood. The FUS was short-lived too, however, as on September 18th, Unaro joined Eisenland as a state. And this was understandably Eisenland's last experiment with international organizations, as the Sparwood region was just too unstable. Eisenland was pretty dormant, both domestically and internationally, for the next couple of months, with the only real noteworthy things that happened during this time period being construction and completion of projects that were already established in the past. Magstat continued to grow, Eisenland's older cities were renovated, a national highway was created. Eisenland also managed to purchase a lot of land from Tortuga, on which nothing really that interesting has been done with yet. Eisenland's relatively dormant state wouldn't last long, however, as on December 10th, Loic officially announced his return to Rathnir after falling from grace in Veodoxa. Loic had maintained contact with Eisenland leaders after the Negative Four War, and in his time of need, Eisenland decided to return the favor. Loic made his dramatic return on the steps of the capital building of Magstat. Now, I'm not going to go in depth on the Veodoxan Civil War, as I'm more than positive that there are plenty of other places that have documented the battles and the politics of the conflict, but do know that this was a long and drawn-out process, and that Eisenland suffered minimal losses in the conflict, besides a battle that took place in Magstat. It wasn't until January 28th in which the fighting ended with a resounding victory for Loic's forces, and the war came to a close. Following the end of the war, Eisenland and the new Veodoxa were incredibly close, and decided to merge their countries with the Union. Magstat was chosen as the capital of this union, and Hero, due to his immeasurable work put into helping the cause and his incredible skill in the battlefield, was installed in the Union's government as a region archon and a military general. And that's it. I know it's a bit of an abrupt ending, but that is where Eisenland's story is at right now. I don't have much else to say, but I do want to say that playing on this Minecraft server truly has been something special, and nothing like I've ever done before, and that I'm looking forward to seeing where Eisenland can go in the future. And with that, I thank you for watching the video, and have a good day.